and I'm Tourism Poor in Lambeth. Care packages are cut without warning, assessments not completed properly, paperwork gets lost, and it has to be said, standard social worker is poor. They are often incompetent, untrained, and dishonest. They lie to us and about us. Any strategy or policy regarding disabled people, elderly people, and unpaid carers depends on this infrastructure working well. What would you do to improve standards in Lambeth Social Services, and how will you monitor any improvement?
Do you want to go first, darling?
It's such a big issue, and you know, in Lambeth we have a one-party state. It is 59 or 58, to take away Rachel Hayward and the independent Labour councillors, and 4 opposition councillors. And I believe therefore this council has become complacent. And that's why we need opposition councillors holding the council to account. What can those opposition councillors do? Because your question, and I'm aspiring to be one in the local elections where I'm standing in St Leonard's. It is, first of all, to hold a mirror up to what's going on and to highlight and shout very, very loudly. Now, what the Labour Council relies on is that voice not being strong enough, not being loud enough, because we are fighting on so many fronts. You know, we're just a handful of opposition councillors. So it is trying to find those examples and shouting very, very loudly about them and bring them to the attention of the media, just to try and get that attention, just to get that coverage. So with older residents, we were fighting to defend sheltered housing in my ward, where I am. I managed to do it, but it was by getting it on the front page of the South London Press. And we know that the council are very conscious of their PR image, so that is the way to kind of push a button. It is about scrutiny. It's about using the mechanisms of the council, the scrutiny committees, as much as we can in the appropriate services to scrutinise what's going on and to draw attention to it. One of the binds, of course, is that the scrutiny committees are chaired by Labour councillors. You know, so again, it is very hard to get the scrutiny committees to function as effectively as you know they should do. And it is also about, I think, you know, taking an analogy from fly tipping, another area. You get resources put into something when you report and report and report and report incidents of fly tipping, or with the police, you get the police to put resources into an area by reporting crime and reporting crime and reporting crime. Learn that. As chair of my local ward panel that sets the priorities for local policing. It's the same with this. It's about actually putting in complaints, and then it's escalating the complaints. And I know this doesn't sound like, you know, it's going to suddenly be a silver bullet overnight. It's not. And this is going to be a long, hard fight. But this is the way that we start to fight, and we start to fight back against what's going on, to expose, to scrutinise, and shout very, very loudly, and complain, and complain, and escalate right up until things change.
Shall I ask a question again so that Jackie can hear?
Yes, please. Yeah, thanks.
Sorry, I'm coming up
with. Are you ready for the question, Jackie?
Yeah, I'm just getting off the page, so I'll bring it down.
So my question was, social services are notoriously poor in Lambeth. Care packages are cut without warning, assessments are not completed properly, paperwork gets lost, and it has to be said that the standard of social worker is poor. They are often incompetent, untrained and dishonest. They lie to us and they lie about us. Any strategy or policy regarding disabled people, elderly people and unpaid carers depends on this infrastructure working well. What would you do to improve standards in Lambeth Social Services, and how will you monitor any improvement?
Well, if Charlie can come in then, you can, if you want to come in after Charlie, please.
Yes, of course. So the key problem is lack of oversight. There seems to be very little oversight over what going on in social care from the council. There isn't the level of care there that there needs to be, ironically. So one of the things I would love to see is a more robust, more independent, more transparent appeals process, whereby if you disagree with a decision that's been made, you know you have a clear right to appeal that decision. That decision doesn't go through your specific social worker, so you're not having to argue with the person who made that decision. Which means your social worker can stop being your enemy and start being your advocate, which they need to be. A social worker has to be an advocate for you, and that's the position that we should be taking as a council. I want to see greater care support for carers in terms of respite funding. So, to use a personal example, I recently started a new job, That job involves working 48-hour weeks, including full night shifts and long ambulance service. I was told that we asked for an increase in my mother's care hours. We were given 2 hours a week of extra care, and I was told I was entitled to no respite care support at all. That needs to change. We need more support to give carers the time off that they need so that they can engage in study, engage in work. We need to give more support to disabled people so they can engage in study and work. And there should be a presumption, always there should be a presumption, that when you have your care package designed for you, there should be a presumption that there is some element of you engaging in study or work if that's an option that's available for you. Whether that's through the OU or working from home or going out to work or whatever, there should be a presumption that part of the job of your care package is to help you make your life better and to keep you mentally and physically active as far as possible. I also want to improve links with Dazzle for giving people who are on direct payments proper support, because I feel like quite often you're just kind of left to your own devices. If you don't already know about Dazzle, nobody at the council is telling you about them. So making sure we've got those clear links where you're clearly signposted to Dazzle and other organisations that can help you, to make sure that you are able to be an advocate for yourself. Because again, your social worker with the best will in the world. Social work departments are hugely overstretched. They don't have the ability to have an in-depth knowledge of all of their cases. And if I could make it so that each person had an individual social worker who only worked on their case, I absolutely would, but that's not practical. So what we need to do is train disabled people, train elderly people, and train their carers and carers in general into how to be better advocates for themselves and where to get the support they need to become those advocates. And essentially that's it, it's advocacy training. There's a lot of what it boils down to.
Thanks, Charlie. Jackie, would you like to respond?
Right.
Yes.
Social services and the health service to get really one sector, they're very intertwined. And they're under tremendous pressure at the moment across the country. Demand is growing, the costs are going up, and the funding that we get isn't meeting the gap. So the gap is growing. This is not just here, it's across the whole country. I'm sure you know from links with other organisations. And even the Local Government Association, which represents all councils, which is run by the Tories, by Tory leaders of Tory councils, they are always hassling the government to get more money for social care, because it is underfunded. So the whole, but it's not just social care, it's the fact that social service and the health service are under tremendous pressure. We can see that, and we see that in our daily lives, but we can also see it on these TV programmes that are showing these doctors and nurses in despair when they can't get people in the right place. So the whole sector is under a lot of pressure, which means this is not the ideal situation for changing things and transforming services, which is what we do need to do nationally. We've been waiting for the government, because at the end of the day, it's about government funding. We put a lot of money into the social services, but we really need the whole thing funded properly from government. And the government has been talking for a very long time about a green paper, and he's given us several deadlines, but it seems like they seem more likely to come up with this one in the summer. So that is really going to start talking about how we do fund health and social care sector across the piece for the foreseeable future in a sustainable way. And it may well mean people are going to have to pay more income tax. It may well mean people have got to pay more in national insurance. It may well mean that they'll be asking people who have their own homes to contribute to the care, but that's a particularly difficult issue because it ends up being a tax on certain people and not others. So when that is going to be a key way forwards. But in the meantime, we can't just stand still. So what we're doing in Lambeth, we're transforming the way health and social care work together by bringing the services together much more closely. And it's to be so there'll be a lot less overlap. You will have to keep talking to people, several people at different times and going to different places. So we're trying to work a sort of joint service, service there at the local level, number one. Secondly, people do need a lot more information. Everybody I meet could do with more information. And unfortunately, the government's got this policy of digital by default. And they don't, they just think everybody should be online or have an iPhone. Not everybody has an iPhone always online. Not everybody's got broadband at home. So there's a real issue here about how do we communicate. Okay, we communicate, because people desperately need information about, because in fact there are quite a lot of services in our community, but we don't all know about them, so information is one of the key ones. But finally, I think the whole issue around the workforce, and I think your point about the advocacy, what we want is our social workers, instead of going through a list and saying, oh, you can't do this, you can't do that, you can't do that, we want them to look at people's lives in a much more positive way, so you can do this, what would you like to do, and move it, transform as we work more closely with health into that sort of model.
Can I just make a point? Sorry, my question, don't mind. What we do need in Lambeth, Jackie, is a review of current social services. It's the quality, lack of quality, and the way that they treat us, the disabled people, elderly people, healthcare carers, that is at fault. Now, for the past 5 years,
Laura, we have a programme. Please, respect the programme. Respect the programme, please. Otherwise, it just turns into mayhem. We have a free-for-all. Please, bring these in. We may have time towards the end. Thanks, Laura.
Can I have an observation?
No observations on response. Please, we do not have that factored in to the time. We just don't.
In then holding these people to account if we're gone.
The thing is, we've agreed on a number of questions. Does that mean that other questions will drop off? And that's unfair to people who have got questions to answer. So the third one is Ian. So I'll ask you, Ian. The two Ians. I'll ask you the third question, please. Your question, please. I think it's on. Is it on transport?
Yeah.
Thanks.
How will you ensure that local transport planning takes into account the needs and views of local deaf and disabled people?
Okay, let's start from Charlie and work this way.
So primarily, the fact is that the local transport is fundamentally accessible in so many places, which obviously impacts on things like the ability of disabled people and carers to access study and work. If you can't get on the train or on the bus, you can't after all get to a school or a college or to a workplace. I'd like to see, as a basic standard, that at least 50 to 66% of our stations becoming accessible within Lambeth, and make sure that that's spread out so that people are never too far from an accessible station. So for example, Loughborough Junction would be a perfect example of a station you could make more accessible, and that would obviously involve working with Network Rail, with the various rail companies, ensuring that access routes by bus stops are kept free, so making sure the paving is in good repair, making sure that, making sure paving is in good repair, making sure that traffic markings are well signposted, even instituting more cameras to prevent people parking in front of bus stops, parking in front of drop curbs, all the rest of the lovely things that that people in cars love to do to get in our way. And also making sure that things like dial-a-load and accessible services are properly funded and properly accessible, making sure that taxi cars and things like that are properly accessible to as many people as possible. I would love to see a scheme where, for example, we're offering training to minicab drivers in basic BSL, so that deaf people can access minicabs more easily, and teaching them how to use things like Type Talk and things like that, and making sure those schemes are open and transparent, and giving people the best access to the best transport. And that would apply, I mean, obviously that would have to apply to things like bus drivers as well. Because even basic BSL can make such a difference to how you can interact with the world around you. If you use a different language, having people around you who use that language automatically makes your world that bit more accessible. And that's the same whether it's BSL or Makaton or even Braille if you're producing written materials. It's a travesty that we don't have a facility to produce Braille documents on things like bus timetables and things like that. There is no reason why a bus timetable has to be a written timetable or has to be a flashing light bulb. There's no reason why you can't have Braille overlays on it that would improve accessibility for people with visual impairments and enable them to be more independent, because they wouldn't be relying on somebody who can see, oh, what's the bus that's coming up? What time is this bus due? Where does this bus go? Because they'd be able to find that information for themselves.
Okay, Charlie. Thank you. I'll miss you around. I'll be checking next. Please.
Okay. Four or five years ago, I was doing a pedestrian survey in a northern town, and I walked down a high street with a man with a visual impairment who had a guide dog. I've never forgotten that journey. He pointed out so many obstacles I had never thought about. I know there's a lot more to do. Now, if we just fix the odd thing, it's not much point just fixing the odd thing. What we need to do is have a proper policy and a proper guidance so that we don't get things wrong in the first place. So the London Mayor has got a planning document for accessibility, Accessible London, which covers quite a lot of different things. And what we need to do is turn that into a local document, local design guide for each of our town centres and
where we're designing. Sorry, Jack, we need to do a question about accessibility.
I won't talk about that. I'll talk more about transport then, sorry. Okay, so transport in where we are. There's the neighbourhood transport, and then there's the borough transport, and then there's the London transport. So it all operates at different levels and needs a lot of investment. I did see the House of Lords Select Committee did a fantastic review of transport and said how there's a whole lot of legislation that is in place to enable disabled people to travel more easily, but it just hasn't been enacted over 20 years, and we need more specific regulations on transport to make sure these things are done faster than they are. We do need it at these different levels. And the best way to do that at the local level, which is what we can influence as councils and neighbourhood local level, we need to have a strong voice of people. We need to co-produce these design guides and transport plans with people, not for people, with people. So we need to have some mechanisms for doing that perhaps more effectively than they've done in the past. So that's one of the things we'll be looking at. We did the Equalities Commission over the last year and then followed up with a very detailed, more specific report on disability alone, which went to Cabinet on the 18th of March. And there's quite a number of actions there that are not directed at adult social care, because this is not a responsibility for adult social care, it's a responsibility for the whole council. So the Environment and Highways Department looks after transport, and they need to be much more aware of disability. And the key issue that came out of these reports is that our staff need to be more aware. They're not deliberately avoiding tackling these problems, they're just not aware. And once they become aware, like I was in this town centre work, it makes a huge difference. So we are going to be doing a big, what we want to do is a big programme of awareness raising and staff who are dealing with these at the front line, thinking how to engage with people with disabilities and also to design new things, looking for best practice, because there's a lot of best practice out there. And the other thing is, now we're in 2018 and we're in London, which is one of the tech cities of the world, there's a lot of technological solutions which we need to explore and make work better. And I think we are getting more talking timetables and things like that are coming in. There's no reason why we can't do those. But we need to look at what we can do at the neighbourhood, borough and London level and operate, work out things at those levels and have a voice at each of those levels.
Thank you, Jackie. Brian Jonathan, please.
Thanks. I think Charlie's made a really good list of things. I'd like to add a few things to it as well. I think the question was about how we can actually ensure that there's a presence and a voice heard. So I've been working with Transport for All for many years, and I think having that influence at the kind of, to influence TfL, as Jackie said, you know, a lot of decisions are made at the TfL level. To have that stakeholder engagement is really, really important as free transport for all. But again, I think the council could have been doing a lot more. For example, when the bins, you know, there was that big change in bin policy, what was it, 6-8 years ago, where you have to put bins out on the street.
I James, we're coming to that.
For the Green Party, this is part of transport. there was no equality impact assessment done. Yeah. I use this as an illustration that a proper, meaningful equality impact assessment should be done on all changes of policy and how they impact transport, and it wasn't in this case. There are the issues around awareness for bus drivers. There's enforcement again of the A boards on the high road. You know, there was a big push, and then I know straight on the high road today, the A boards are right out there, which is really going to cause problems for mobility. The paving roads, Charlie mentioned, in terms of, we just had a setback at Streatham Station, where we worked very, very hard to get money from the Section 106 money from the hub development, and also the council matched the funding, which was great, to get a lift installed at Streatham Station. But then the government's cut the programme. So it will now be put 4 years back. To be working with organisations like Transport for All to try and bring that forward, I think is absolutely crucial in terms of stakeholder engagement. And also looking at creative alternatives, and this is where local councils can really make a difference. So at Streatham Station, this again is an illustration, when we realised there's going to be a long time in getting those lifts, we looked at how level access could be introduced, and we got a gate put on the other side, so at least on one side now, Streatham Station, there is level access without using the stairs. It's about having good, effective ward councillors who can spot these opportunities. Work with London Assembly members as well, because there's these decisions, and Network Rail, whoever it might be, in order to get the changes, and be proactive in it. And again, it's about prioritisation. You know, these things should be a priority. You know, we are, as Jackie said, in 2018, we shouldn't be fighting these battles any longer. You know, the struggles of getting accessible taxis. I have friends who, you know, will order Ubers. I don't use Uber as a matter of principle, but I have friends that do. And finding an accessible Uber is really, really problematic. So they have to get actually that personal name of the driver and the driver's mobile number. You can't use the app in order to get it. You've actually got to call up the driver. We need to be pressuring Uber and using the mayor's office to pressure Uber where they're failing in order to produce more accessible Ubers as a percentage of the overall Uber drivers, and put more into their fleet. So there are ways that can be done too.
Thanks, John.
Sorry, just before you start, can we get the water?
Sorry, thank you. So just to please say, Unite in this region is going to carry out a transport summit in the very near future. So input from organisations will be very, very, very much invited. I'll put that out as it develops. Okay, we're now coming on to question 4, I think, Ray, and it's on housing.
Yeah, we have a very bad housing crisis all over the country, and particularly in Lambeth. We have rampant gentrification and the laughable regeneration. Market forces don't work for us. So what are you going to do to increase the volume of genuinely affordable housing? And we don't mean 80% of market rents. And what are you going to do about accessible social housing in this borough? And will you ensure the disabled facilities grant is increased to reflect the increasing costs? Because a decent home is a fundamental need.
Thank you for that. I'm going to turn it around and ask Jackie to answer. First, you have an opportunity to come in first at some point.
Yeah. I cannot agree more. The home is the most important thing that people where everybody needs a decent home that suits them, suits their lifestyle and their needs. We get the disability facilities grant. We do get that through government, and we spend it jointly with the health service, and we're spending quite a lot of that every year. But I think what you're talking about is accessible homes. And in Lambeth, we have got a lot of Victorian houses. We've got a lot of 50s and 60s council flats. And we're getting more new ones. but we, which are being built to lifetime home standards, but they're not really fully accessible. So what we're going to be building some new council homes. We are going to be doing some bespoke council homes in there, designed for individuals. And one of the first schemes we're doing is a Coburg Crescent, where we're building a centre there, and it's going to have very bespoke flats incorporated into it as a day centre, cafe, and so we're going to actually really work out a modern smart homes, because the sort of technology we've got nowadays is fantastic, but you've got to build it in. It's a lot easier to build it into a new home than it is to build it into an old home. Rents are very tricky because of the land values. But that's why we need to build as much social housing as we can. We have managed to, as a cost of borough, managed to get 40% of the new build at affordable rents.
Where?
Well, some of them haven't been built yet, but they've been part of the deals. They've been part of the deal. So it's 40%, which is, it's not as high as, I mean, it's pretty, it's not, it's, it's higher than other places and not as high as other places, but we are going through that 40%. But one of the most contentious issues of this election, let's not beat about the bushes, about the new estates or the regeneration of the estates. What we've got here, because we've got 22,000 people on our housing list, the only way we're going to build a substantial number of new council homes is to build on our own land. Because there's not that much, where's the spare land in the borough? There's hardly any, not enough to build thousands of new homes. So we want to rebuild our estates that will cost a lot of money to refurbish as brand new homes, bit by bit, keep the community together, build them bit by bit so that they, and build in, integrate those disabled access homes where people need them, and build a few extra ones in so we've got some more. We've also done a lot of work for older people on the extra care. We're building in new extra care schemes, which are proving quite popular as well. But it's, as you said, it's a big issue for London. It's a big issue for South East. It's a big issue for an awful lot of the country. And it needs a lot of support from government, and some good policies from government to enable this to happen. Because it's a very tricky situation.
Thanks, Jackie. And Jonathan, next.
DFG first of all, Ray. I think my son's had two DFGs, and the amount of money that is wasted over disabled facilities grant in contractors who are paying, have been paid way over the odds to do what should be very, very basic work and cheap work and not do it very, very well. There needs to be much better scrutiny of finances, and we can get far more out of the disabled facilities grant that way. And that's why I've supported the people's audit that has scrutinised Lambeth's finances and show, you know, it's happening right across the board, not just over disabled facilities grant, but with contractors right all over the place. But let me come on to regeneration, right? So these six estates that are being bulldozed against residents' wishes, there should be a ballot of those residents, a meaningful population, so they have a determination over their future and what should happen to their homes. At Cressingham Gardens, they produced a people's plan. And they presented it to the council, and it would have produced far more social homes and kept, and properly, genuinely affordable homes, and kept those communities together, not the social cleansing that's been pursued by this council. In terms of the housing waiting list, the council made £76 million by destroying housing co-ops and selling that short-life housing off to developers, and then taking those people and putting them to the top of the council house waiting list so the people on the bottom had to wait even longer.
Wow.
And not one penny of that money went into building new social housing.
Wow.
This is an absolute scandal
in Lambeth.
So it is not good enough to blame central government for this. The blame falls fairly on and squarely on Lambeth Council's shoulders.
Charlie, can you respond to the same question, please?
Just to echo what Johnson was saying about to come to the disabled facilities grant, it's a joke. Lambeth consistently goes for the cheapest provider, regardless of whether that's actually the most cost effective. We've had complete cowboys come in. Seriously, like, They had, we had to get them to put in new joists, and they went for the cheapest provider, and they literally just soared through our floorboards. So now the upstairs floor is unsafe because the floorboards have been cut to ridiculous proportions. They're breaking in half. It's got to be about, and then Lambeth are having to spend more money putting that right. And it just ends up wasting money. I'd like to see us refusing to approve schemes that don't have at least 50% living homes, homes for life standard accessible properties. Properties that can be made more accessible as people get older. I'd like to see us refusing to approve social housing that doesn't have at least 10% of already accessible, and that means wet rooms, it means alarm systems, it means tracking hoist systems if needed. Minimum 10%. I'll start low because I don't have a lot of faith in Lambeth yet. I wouldn't want to challenge them too early on. Lambeth Lib Dems are backing a tenants' ballot for housing estate regeneration, as with the Greens, so people can be rest assured that if their community doesn't want their estate redeveloped, then it won't be, and we'll have to look at another way, whether that's utilising the green space, whether that's using new technology that enables you to build from the top up and create more homes on flat level roofs, whether that's maybe splitting properties or rethinking the way we organise the housing list. There are lots more single people than there used to be. There is no reason why you can't look at, homes that used to be family homes and go, how can we adapt these and split them into flats so that we can increase the densification while still providing good quality homes that people can live in at a reasonable rate. I also want to say it's an absolute disgrace that when you do get your disabled facilities grant, there's quite a lot of housing associations and the council that say, if you move out, we will rip out all the adaptations. Because that's what, when we moved into our current plastic place, we got, I think, about £60,000 disabled facilities grant. They moved walls, they put in a fully accessible ramp, they moved walls around, they put in a through floor lift, they put in a wet room, and we were told, if you ever move out, we'll rip it all out, and it will just go back into the general housing stock. It's a waste. It's an absolute waste. Why spend all that money and then turn around and go, we'll just chuck it on the tip?
Thank you, John. Yeah, that is a thanks, John. Thank you. Finally, on this question, sorry, it was the last one, sorry. Right, so we'll go on to question five, please. Helen, please.
Cuts to social care funding are undermining disabled people's dignity, independence, choice and control. How will you ensure social care support needs of local disabled people are met?
Thanks, Helen. Right, let's do this now. Let's go with Charlie first.
Social care is complicated because it's such an individualised thing.
Yeah.
Some people will want to be left well enough alone and just give me the money and I'll get on with it myself. Some people will want or need far more intensive support with how they manage their social care. As far as I'm concerned, it should always be down to the individual's choice. It should always be up to you to decide how much input you want from the council or from voluntary services in managing recruitment of PAs, in managing payroll, holiday, things like that. I know Dazzle runs a scheme that actually supports people on direct payments. I'd like to see that rolled out bigger. I'd like to see Lambeth funding that properly so that everyone who gets direct payments can go through that scheme, at least gets the offer of a place. Whether they choose to take that up or not is obviously going to be down to them. I'd like to see more training for disabled young people so that they can go from, like Jonathan's son, who can go from relying on you to manage his care so that he can become an employer in his own right. He gets the training to be able to do that as he gets older. And it's so much of social care, so much of being disabled is about being taught how to advocate for yourself. And I'm really lucky in that I had a mother who grew up in the disability movement and who got me involved in the Centre for Independent Living, in GLAD, in Dazzle, in all of these organisations. So when I became disabled myself, I had the skills to advocate for myself. I was so lucky I went and got a law degree so that I can advocate for myself. And there are so many people who don't have that opportunity, who don't have that knowledge, and we need to give it to them. We need to give people who are on social care the chance to come back to the council. I'd love to see direct payments users and people who are in receipt of social care. I'd love to see more forum, more community building. Lambeth have been saying for years they're the cooperative council. For years and years they're the cooperative council, but they never talk to us. I've never once been invited to sit down with councillors and talk about what it's like to be somebody who relies on social care as a carer, as the child of a disabled parent, as somebody who has been expected to, who was told, go away, you've got to cook your own meals, you've got to do this, you've got, oh no, we're not gonna arrange care for your mother as a parent, so that she can look after you and your sibling. You've got to do it all. And this has gone on since I was a child. This has gone on since, Lambeth Labour are too fond of blaming central government, but this has been going on since well before 2010. This has been going on my entire life. I've been told over and over again, you don't matter, it's not important, we don't care about you. Over and over again, and it's got to stop.
Yes.
If anybody else treated your kids like that, they call it child abuse.
Yeah.
Thanks, Charlie. And, Charlie, thank you. Well, Sally, thanks very much. Let me see how we're working this. Jackie, please, could you?
Right. Please. I know people, I think we do have to get real about the money. This is the age of austerity. Government has cut funding to local authorities enormously. When we had a Labour government in 2010, this borough had £100 million a year extra on top of the council tax we get from council taxpayers and business rates we get from businesses. £100 million a year extra. That has now been cut by the Tories by 65% so far and will go down to zero in the next couple of years by 2020. They believe councils must be self-sufficient on their businesses and residents. That is a lot of money, £100 million a year. It's a lot of money and has made a difference, and it has made it more difficult. But the other issue, as I said in the beginning, that there's a mystic point here about, but it's the way social care and health work together, and you can't really have one without the other, and they do work. We're trying to do in Lambeth is we need to transform. Services across the country, we do need to transform the NHS and care service. As we get an ageing population, we do need to transform it in some way. And people don't, and that's, we're working on that in Lambeth. And Manchester is doing a lot of work there, trying to bring everything together. It takes a long time to transform services, and it really helps if you've got more money to do the transformation. So it's struggling to transform with less overall money.
You've got enough money to paint a flaming bridge, which ain't yours.
Yeah, come on.
Well,
that
was
a...
Can we now, please?
So coming back to social care funding, in 2014 we had the Care Act became law. The Care Act, I think people were, across the piece, were quite enthusiastic about the Care Act because it brought in a systematic system across the whole country. So the same criteria, instead of having one council doing this and one council that. So it eliminated the postcode lottery, but unfortunately it came in just at a time when there wasn't enough money to make it work properly. So the system is under a great deal of stress, as I said, but what we have managed to do in Lambeth, we have managed to do is to protect our social care budgets. We have managed to protect those. There's still a lot of pressure on them, and through all the lobbying that's been going on, the government has, at the very last minute, they give us at the very last minute say, oh, well, you can have a bit more money. So we've got enough money to keep us going now for the next couple of years, but what we don't know is how we're going to sustain the funding in the
the years ahead, which is where the government is coming up with this green paper, which they've been talking about for a long time, and we do need to discuss that and see how that's going to, if it comes out in the summer, as we're supposed to do. But it's, and it could be such a transformational process, this, the green paper, could be, we don't know, that it's going to change the way we tax people in this country. We do need to get sort of cross-party support to that. And I think most of the parties are quite keen, or some of the, there's enough people in each of the parties who can see that is the way forward, that we do need to, it's a big, big process, similar to the Care Act, about cross-party support. We need to get cross-party support to future funding. And it's, a, it's, we're talking about masses and masses of money here, billions of pounds.
Thanks, finally on this question, John.
Oh, sorry, can I just
use that for
a minute?
No, sorry,
the thing is, Jacqueline's not asking another question, she keeps raising it.
Look, okay, do you know what? You've got a choice then at the ballot box, isn't it? That's what this is about. I can't dictate what people say.
No, go on.
They'll answer the questions they make. And people can then make their own minds up. That's what this is about. Please.
You are right.
Thanks a lot. Thank you for that. Jonathan.
Thanks. I may be about to say what Laura was going to say, but it seems to be a pattern here. We're getting blame from Lambeth Labour for central government cuts, and we know these cuts are happening. But what I'm hearing from you, and what I'm hearing from Charlie, and what I'm knowing from my own experience, is actually there's a lot of things which the council could do to make life better. And you're suggesting them, I'm suggesting them, Charlie's suggesting them, and all we're getting is a complete rejection. They're not listening. They're not listening. Social care is an investment. It is an investment, and actually it will save us money in the long term if we get it right. We all know that when you have carers that work well, when you have a relationship with those carers, when that, those carers understand the people that they're caring for and the needs, it works. We need to be able to keep those carers and retain them, and they need to be valued, and they need to know that they're valued. We need flexibility in the use of direct payments. So we are encouraged, you know, when you have the opportunity to be creative and be supportive in creative arts and music and other things, then those things stand us all in good stead. We all flourish, we all get better, we get mentally better well-being ourselves from having to be able to do that. The council could have ring-fenced the money from the former independent living fund. Other councils did it. This council did not do it. And taking up the point about transition as well, going from children to adult care, this is something I'm going through at the moment. There are immense challenges, and we're not getting the support and the advice and the expertise that we need from the council to be able to do that, to be able to plan that pathway for my son's future. I know that a lot of other children are experiencing that. These are not things with immediate financial implications. This is about the quality. This is about the commitment. It's about listening to deaf and disabled people and saying, this is what we need, and then making sure this happens. What we don't need is another huge, great plan from central government to make these things work. No. What we actually need is the political will and the responsiveness of the council to make this work, to make social care work.
Thank you all for going on with the meeting. So we now have a question from